Welcome, my friends. Today we will discuss
the Central Limit Theorem.
The easiest way to do that is through an example. Imagine a restaurant where it takes an average of 16 minutes for a customer to be served their food with a standard deviation of 6.35 minutes. We only know the mean and standard deviation of the wait times and aren't sure of the shape of the distribution. If x represents the wait time of a customer at the restaurant in minutes, then x has an unknown distribution with a mean of 16 and a standard deviation of 6.35. Let's say we take a sample of size 30 from this distribution and calculate the mean. Here are the 30 observations. Time waited is a continuous variable, so we could have decimal values, but the observations have been rounded to the nearest whole number for convenience. The mean of these 30 wait times is about 15.37 minutes. Notice the sample mean is close but not exactly equal to the population mean of 16, which is to be expected when sampling. Suppose we take another sample of size 30. The mean turns out to be 14.3 this time. In the real world, you would only take one sample, but for explanation purposes, we can take as many samples of size 30 as we want. Here are the first three sample means that I generated, each with a sample size of 30. Here are 5. Here's 10. Here's 50. And here are over 100 sample means. Each mean was calculated from a sample of size 30 from the original distribution. Notice that even though each sample mean was taken from the same population, they are different due to the nature of sampling. Each sample mean can be thought of as coming from a distribution of sample means, if we were to treat each value as an individual observation. This is what we call a sampling distribution, which is the basis of the central limit theorem. Here's the first super important thing for you to understand about the central limit theorem, so make sure you're paying attention. The central limit theorem applies to the distribution of these numbers, the sample means, which make up the so-called sampling distribution. What type of distribution does the sample mean x bar have? Your choices are A, the same distribution as the individual observation x, which have some unknown distribution with a mean of 16 and a standard deviation of 6.35, or B, x bar has some other distribution. If you answered B, you are correct. The sampling distribution of x bar does not have the same distribution as x. Taking averages happens to change the initial distribution in an amazingly predictable and conveniently useful way. Here is the distribution of a sample of 20,000 individual values. It's very spread out and all observations are between 5 and 27, with a mean of 16. It looks quite a bit like a uniform distribution, and the samples were actually generated from a uniform distribution. But to emphasize that this could be any distribution, I'll leave it as a question mark for now. Here's the distribution of sample means of size 30, taken from the original x distribution. Just like in the first slide, where I found two sample means, I've done this 20,000 times to get 20,000 sample means and graphed the distribution. Do you notice anything special about the distribution of x bar?
It's a flippin' normal distribution!
This is the amazingly predictable and conveniently useful fact about sampling distributions. The amazingly predictable part is that we can predict that the sampling distribution x bar will be bell-shaped and symmetrical like a normal distribution, regardless of the distribution of x, as long as the sample size is large enough. It's amazing because it doesn't matter if the original distribution is left-skewed, right-skewed, bimodal, uniform, or anything else. The central limit theorem says that the distribution of sample means will be approximately normal with a large enough sample size. The conveniently useful part is that we know a lot about normal distributions, and if we know that any sampling distribution from any population is normal, so long as the sample size is large enough, that makes it much easier to calculate probabilities and make inferences about the population. At this point, I've basically explained the central limit theorem, but let's write out the definition. The central limit theorem states that for any probability distribution, the sampling distribution of sample means x bar will have a distribution that approaches the normal distribution as the sample size n increases. Here are some
bonus facts.
A general rule of thumb is that the sample size n should be greater than or equal to 30 in order for the central limit theorem to apply. Highly skewed distributions might need a slightly higher sample size to approximate the normal distribution, and distributions that are already approximately normal might need a much lower sample size, but we generally assume that n must be at least equal to 30 for the central limit theorem to apply. The mean of the sampling distribution is the same as the mean of the original distribution. That is, mu of x bar is the same as mu. This shouldn't be too surprising. If the mean wait time at a restaurant is 16 minutes, the average of 30 means will also have a mean of 16 minutes. This next point is extremely important. The standard deviation of the sampling distribution is equal to the standard deviation of the original distribution divided by the square root of the sample size. This means that the sampling distribution has a smaller standard deviation than the original distribution. The sample means are less spread out than are the observations in the original distribution. This should make intuitive sense. If the mean wait time at a restaurant is 16 minutes, it's relatively likely to wait a really long time on one visit to the restaurant, such as 25 minutes, or a really short time, like 5 minutes, but is much less likely to have consistent very long or very short wait times if the restaurant is visited many times. The distribution of averages will be more compact, less spread out, with a smaller standard deviation than the original data. Remember that in our opening example, the wait time in a restaurant followed some unknown distribution with a mean of 16 minutes and a standard deviation of 6.35 minutes. If x bar represents the average wait time in minutes from a sample of 30 customers, and we remember that the mean of the sampling distribution is equal to the mean of the original distribution, and the standard deviation of the sampling distribution is the standard deviation of the original distribution divided by the square root of the sample size, the central limit theorem says that the sampling distribution of x bar follows a normal distribution with a mean of 16 and a standard deviation of 6.35 divided by the square root of 30, which comes to 1.16. Alright, my friends, we have finished our discussion of the central limit theorem. In the next few videos, we will discuss how to calculate probabilities using the central limit theorem, first with tables, and second with the TI-84 calculator.